Good morning. How's everybody doing today? Welcome to November, and welcome to the time change, and hopefully welcome to fall. Have another tropical depression in the Caribbean, so apparently we're not done with hurricane season yet, but I'm ready for fall. How about you guys? I'm always ready for whatever season change it is. I'm looking forward to the change of season in-house and outside. Amen. I'm glad you're here today. I want to welcome everybody that's here online. We do believe with all of our hearts we have found the issue. It was a piece of equipment overheating. We're making sure it stays cool today, so we should be uninterrupted on our live stream. I want to welcome you today. You can say hello to each other as I am greeting everyone, giving us a few announcements in here. I am Pastor Don. Welcome to the house of the Lord today. We at Destiny Church are a family of believers, loving God and His creation, learning to be followers of Christ through God's holy word, and living out our divine destiny through the leading of the Holy Spirit. We're loving, we're learning, and we're living. And I'm thankful to be in the house of the Lord today. If you have toddlers today or infants, you're welcome to check them into our nursery here, right on the side over here. You can check them in. They can be here through all through service, 0 through 3 years old. Our children are learning the Word of God on their level today, ages 4 through 12. Have children's church today. You can register them right out this doorway here to the corner. Pick them up right after service. Also, our teens meet on Wednesday night in-house in the building from 6 to 8, DC students. You can find more information out about our students and the activities they have through our Facebook page, as well as an Instagram page for DC students. Straight Street Kids still meet on Tuesday nights at 6 p.m. You can go to our Straight Street Facebook page and find more information about that. Also, events for our kids are on there as well. Teresa and I are doing Bible study. I'll share more about that right before I preach the sermon today. We're taking the sermon, expanding it, talking about practical applications. So I'll share more of that with you today before I share the word with you. Also today, we do want you to bring your tithes and your offerings to the house of the Lord. If you're in-house today, you can place them in these boxes at the doorways. If you're online, you can go to our website, destinychurchms.org, and give there, or through our church, through our app. We have an app for our church that you can download through Google Play or Apple iTunes. That's a free app for you. You can also mail them at 42 Office Park Drive, Hattiesburg, Mississippi, 39402. Also today, this evening, we are having Fall Fest for our teenagers, for our middle schoolers, and for our children. Just a time to get together, enjoy the season, celebrate the beginning of fall together. If you want to help today and volunteer, we need you here by 4:30. Also, if you want to help right after church, we're setting up some tables and things here. So you're welcome to help us just stay right after church. We'll get that going very quickly. I'm ready to worship the Lord today. David said it was good when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." That's been on my mind all morning. I'm glad to be in the house today. I'm glad to worship with you in-house. Glad to worship with you guys online. Let's just stand up and let God prepare our hearts to worship today. So many things happen during the course of a week. So many things go on in our lives. So many things that maybe we're heavy about today, or even worried or concerned or anxious, or maybe we have a great week and we're looking to celebrate and give God thanks. Either way, let's just focus on Him in this moment. Lord, we love you today. I'm thankful to be in this house. I'm thankful for the opportunity to serve you. I'm thankful for the opportunity to worship you, God. Lord, we believe when we gather that things change, that you allow our hearts to be more focused on you. Cast our cares upon you today, Lord. Strip the things of the week away. May we know it has been good to be in your house. Receive our worship today in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Let's worship together.
Amen. Lord, whatever goes on here today, we just want it to be what you want it to be, Lord. We just follow you and all that you do. Do what you want to in this house.
We want you and nothing more.
every heart that's hard, Lord, let us make you king.
My song, let the King of my heart.
just meditate on His goodness for just a moment? Father, we thank You today that You're good. Father, You're good on our worst day. You're good on our best day. You're good on the mountain. You're good in the valley. You're good when I'm sick. You're good when I'm well. You're good when I have enough. You're good when I don't have enough. Father, You are good. Let's sing a little bit more of it. He's good today. Don't let the devil lie to you. He's good.
You are good.
Yes, Lord.
You're good.
Hallelujah. Father, we thank You for Your goodness today. We thank You for Your grace. We thank You for Your mercy. We thank You for the healing power of Your Holy Spirit, the stripes of Jesus. Lord, we pray for healing for those who are sick in body today. We pray for deliverance for those that are bound by sin. We pray for salvation for those that don't know You. And God, we pray for a calling home to those that do know You, Lord, but have lost their way or have grown cold. Lord, this world is so full of trouble. Every day has enough trouble of its own. But God, we serve the One that has overcome the world, which is Jesus Christ. And it is in His name that we pray today. And it is His name that we serve. Regardless of what happens Tuesday, Jesus will still be on the throne. And He is my King, and I shall worship Him. Amen. Let's give Him praise in the house today. He's so good. Hey. Hallelujah. Amen. I guess the Lord didn't allow me to sing because I'd just bust right back into it now if I could sing. So I can only yell and I can only share what He gives me in prayer. So if you'll be seated right now, I'll try not to yell anymore and I'll share with you what He shared with me this week. It's good to see your smiling faces. It's good to laugh a little bit. It's good to be in this house with just kind of casting our cares. This world is so full of uncertainty. It's so full of strife, so full of things that are going on. And buckle up. This will be a week for the ages. So we just want to be able to make sure that we're in prayer this week, that we trust God above all things. I'll share a few things in our word and our sermon today. But let me just talk to you really quickly about Wednesday nights, okay? Thank you for all of you who are coming and tuning in. We try to have a little fun on there too. We try to be personable as best we can online. Many of you are tuning in, well over 500 views a week of that time together. And what we're doing, don't think you've heard the sermon today if you're online or here and say, oh, I've already heard that. He's just going to cover the sermon. We do review what we've heard and what God has told us in prayer, but especially this week, so many things that God wants to do in application. So let me just give you a small little snippet of what we'll do Wednesday night. And it's based on a question that one of you asked Teresa. Somebody was talking about, we're talking about serving. That's our theme for the month, that we're saved to serve. And somebody was talking about just giving someone something. And if they came up to you in the parking lot or whatever, and this person was asking a very valid question, a question I ask all the time as well, is this person going to use this money for good? Are they going to use it to just feed their sin habit? Do they really need this money? Am I getting scammed or not getting scammed? A lot of you nodding your heads. God wants us to be comfortable and understand and know what He desires for us to do. So as much as you wonder about doing something, God wants to make sure that we're sure of that. So that's some of the things we'll cover Wednesday night, just some practical application. But today I want to kind of get into our sermon series. We'll take one more week on this, being saved to serve, and then we'll go into a thankfulness series that I'm looking forward to sharing with you for the month of November. And then I feel very strongly and very encouraged and excited about sharing an entire month of Christmas with you. This is a year above all others that we need to focus on the goodness and the gift of Jesus Christ. So I look forward to sharing that with you. Look forward to decorating the house, His house, being festive for this time of year. And I love you today. And I need the Lord. It seems like now more than ever, I have relied on His grace this week and His strength. You know, when you're a young Christian, sometimes you don't think you need grace and strength. But the more I serve Him, the more I realize I need Him. And I need Him today to help me, allow me to just share with you what He's been sharing with me. So would you stretch your hands this way and pray for me today? If you're at home, would you do the same if you're able? God, I love you today. And I confess that I need you now more than ever. I confess, Lord, that I long so, so much for your presence. I want you to saturate our hearts today. I want you to fill me yet again, Lord, that you're working on our hearts. Lord, that's what you keep telling me every day, that it's a heart problem. I need to give you pieces of my heart that I don't even know that I need to yet, Lord. And you desire to pour so much into me so I can overflow. And I pray for every vessel today and that hears this later, Lord, that their vessels would overflow, that our lives would overflow with love and grace and hope and purity. This world needs us now more than ever, God. You have left us here because there are others that need to know you, that need to feel your love and your grace. And we are called, Lord, to serve you and serve others. And I pray today, God, that as I decrease and you increase, that you share this in a way that it would inspire us all. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're talking about being saved to serve. And that's really the process that God wants us to go through. All of us can serve when we hear a need and we're inspired by it, or even some of us can serve even out of obligation. That happens. But really, God desires for us to serve as His children out of the abundance of our relationship with Him. And the way we have relationship is that we're saved through the power, through the blood, through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And so through that ultimate price that Jesus paid, I now can have a relationship with my holy, omnipotent Creator, the Creator of this universe, who is so holy that none of us could be in His presence, who is the essence of purity and goodness, but also the essence of love and grace. And that's why He gave us Jesus, so that we can have access to Him as God, our Heavenly Father. And so what He's telling me, that if I have a serving problem or I have waned in my desire to serve, then I have a heart problem, okay? And so that's really what He wants to deal with all of us, is that we have heart problems. And we talked about some of that last week, that there's matters of our heart that we're dealing with that we're not taking to God, that we're not talking to God about, some because we're embarrassed about it, others because we feel like we should be over this by now. Other things are wounds that we've suppressed, just all kinds of different things that through prayer we can find that. And prayer is what we're going to focus on a lot today. We focused a lot on it last week, but we're going to get back to it again today because that's our communication. That's our relationship. And so we are called by God to serve Him and serve others. And there was a point in my walk with Him where I became, and I'll share some of that with you today and more on Wednesday night, where I became so overwhelmed and so full and so grateful about what He had done for me that I no longer approached Him every day in prayer or even in a service like this and looked for what I could receive only. I began to think about And I began to pray and I began to earnestly ask, what might I do to serve you? And out of that abundance and out of that overflow is how all of us can really keep that desire to serve. And that's what we're going to look at today, that when that happens, we just say yes. So we're going to look at the power of yes, really just in prayer daily, saying yes. Yes to the Lord, yes to His will, yes to His way, yes to being used. I stand before you today, not because of one big yes. I'm going to talk about a significant yes and a significant point in my life where I took some relief, but I also took a total submission to God and His will. But I stand before you today because of daily yeses along the way. Hundreds and not thousands of just every day saying, Lord, whatever you want, I want to do it, because I know whatever you want me to do, I was created to do it. And I know that when I do it, I can bring you glory. I remember stirring in me what I'm talking about, that I had this great desire to be used. And so in a service, I just came up and said, Lord, I want you to use me. And I felt His call on my life. And many would call that call to ministry. But I would say to you today that we're all called to minister in some way. And at that time, I knew, oh, no, I'm not going to preach. No, I'm certainly not going to pastor. That's too hard, and people are too mean, and I don't want to do that. I just want to do something. Can I go on a mission trip and build something? And so that's what I started to do. I started saving my money to go on a mission trip, and I did. I went to Nicaragua and helped build a feeding center for some orphan children. But I remember talking to my pastor before I left, and I said, I feel called to do something. I feel God's call in my life. I feel Him pulling on me, but I don't know what to do. I don't know. He's not saying anything. I'm searching. Does that sound familiar to anybody? I'm trying to figure out what that is, but I don't know what that is. And then he said to me, my pastor, Steve McCullough, said, Don, you've said yes to the Lord, and really the rest is up to Him. Leave here in peace today. You're about to go on a mission trip. And later he told me he felt like I was being called into pulpit ministry. He didn't tell me that day. Praise the Lord. He didn't tell me. I would have flipped out. But he said, you're about to go on this mission trip, and I'll share more about that at another day. And God spoke greatly and powerfully along that mission trip, but you've said yes. And really, that's all God's asking of us today. And really, that's all God asks of us any day and every day, is that we say yes. And I want us to do that in prayer as we close later today. And I want us to do that and begin to make that a daily habit. When we talked about last week, presenting ourselves as a living sacrifice. Remember that in Romans 12? That daily I present myself as a living sacrifice. I say, here I am, Lord, use me, just like Isaiah. The Bible is full and covered up with people that said yes. Beginning with Abraham after the fall, he said yes to God, to yes to His will, yes to His way, even though he didn't know where he was going. God gave him something, said, I'm about to lead you into a land where you're going to multiply, and even though your wife is barren now, your descendants will outnumber the sands on the seashore. Abraham, that should have seemed so out of place to him, and it did, and it was a long journey, but Abraham said yes, and really the rest was up to God. And I think about Peter, who we're going to talk a lot about today in the New Testament. Jesus came along and told Peter, follow me. Peter left his nets, which he was cleaning. He was a fisherman, and he said yes, and he followed him. I said yes, and God's asking you to say yes to whatever He's calling on your life today, whatever He's going to say from this point forward, yes. And we're going to look at Peter, because after that group of 120 said yes in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit fell on them. The Holy Spirit not only descended upon them, the Holy Spirit rose out of them. There was an inhabitation of the presence of God in all those people that were there. It overflowed out of their life so that everyone out there heard praises to God and heard them speaking in languages that they knew nothing about. And so that overflow began to stir the early church. 3,000 people came to know God that day. And from then, we see in now Acts chapter 3 that we'll start in today. We're going to look at the first 10 verses in chapter 3 of Acts. From that 120 people, we are here today worshiping God our Creator. God is still revealing Himself on the earth because that group of people said yes. And the leader of that, the one that Jesus said that he would build his church upon, the rock, Peter, is now going to the temple in Acts chapter 3. Let's look at that together. Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. I'm going to read a New Living Translation today. I know many of us know this in a different format, in a different translation, but it reads better for those of us who are learning the word. So let's read it together. Peter and John went to the temple one afternoon to take part in the 3 o'clock prayer service. As they approached the temple, a man lame from birth was being carried in. Each day he was put beside the temple gate, the one called Beautiful Gate, so he could beg from people going into the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked for some money. Peter and John looked at him intently, and Peter said, "Look at us." The lame man looked at them eagerly, expecting some money. But Peter said, "I don't have any silver or gold for you, but I'll give you what I have. In the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, get up and walk." Then Peter took the lame man by the right hand and helped him up. As he did, the man's feet and ankles were instantly healed and strengthened. He jumped up, stood on his feet, and began to walk. Then walking, leaping, and praising God, he went into the temple with them. All the people saw him walking and heard him praising God. When they realized he was the lame beggar they had seen so often at the Beautiful Gate, they were absolutely astounded. Amen to the powerful word of the Lord. Because Peter said yes, God put him in a place where he could be used. And that we think about that miracle and we think about how astounding that is. And believe me, I know God wants to do that today as much as he did that day. And there's many sermons that have been preached, and I've preached several about the miracle of this, the power of the Holy Spirit to heal the lame, to deliver the sick, and all those things that the Holy Spirit does. And we will preach and teach on those again. But today, I want us to look at Peter's heart. Again, God's preparing our hearts. This season we're in right now, where we're wearing masks or not wearing masks, we're worried about getting this disease or not getting these, this too shall pass. There's going to come a day where God's going to call his people back to him. And many have grown cold, and many have grown weary, and many are out there being roughshod and run over by the enemy. God will reveal himself yet again. And those of us who stay the course, those of us who are in this house, we will be ready because we have said yes to receive the harvest that comes in. But before then, we can't help those if we're too busy about worrying about the things that are going on in our lives. So God looks to desire to change our heart, heal us, make us whole. And that's the season we're in right now, okay? So I would love to stir you up about serving today and have a sign-up sheet out there with all kinds of different things going on. But it's not that season yet. God's given us one thing to do. I'll share a little bit about it today. It will be presented to you in the month of November. I'll let you know what it is. But really, right now, he's looking for us to grow deep roots and work on our hearts. The season is coming. Revival is coming. God's going to call his people in. This world grows desperately yearning for God's return. And we as the people need to be ready to receive the harvest. So let's look at prayer, places, and possessions in the framework of this passage of Scripture today, okay? So prayer, I can't say enough about it. It's what cultivates our relationship. It's what gives us strength. It's like daily manna was to the early children of Israel when they were going in the desert. God fed them every day with this wafer-like substance called manna. It was everything they needed. Had all the minerals they need, all the vitamins. It kept them sustained. Prayer is that daily manna for us now. We have to communicate with God to build a relationship with God. Once we build a relationship with God, our hearts overflow with a desire to serve him and serve others. For my heart to become more like Jesus Christ, I need to pray to God the Father, who is and was and is to come, because he sent his son Jesus to save me. My Savior, I know more about him through prayer. Prayer changes things. It changes the way I look at myself. It changes the way I look at God. It changes the way I look at the world. But it also changes the way I look at others. The best way for you and I to get motivated to serve others is to pray for others. So let's look at that in this passage of Scripture here in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. This is so timely for this week that we're entering in this week. 1 Timothy 2, verses 1 through 4, this is Paul's instruction to Timothy. I urge you, first of all, to pray for all people. Say all, all. I urge you, first of all, to pray for all people. Ask God to help them. Intercede on their behalf and give thanks for them. Pray this way for kings and for all who are in authority so that we can live peaceful and quiet lives marked by godliness and dignity. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants everyone to be saved and understand the truth. So we see all in this passage of Scripture, and we see everyone. I will tell you that when God began to work this in my spirit this week, it's been a long time since I remembered that I am to pray for all people. Because some people have been on my nerves. People I don't even know. People I just see that are public figures. Some of them are leaders. And I can't tell you the last time I prayed for them. Some he dropped in my spirit I've never prayed for. But what did the word say right here? I gotta pray for them all. If the devil's stealing your joy through so-and-so, it might be the one beside you. Do not elbow them right now. Pray for them. So what does that mean, Pastor Don? That means I need to pray for every candidate on that ballot this week. It does. It means I need to pray for God's will to be done. We prayed one night in a prayer service in the old building. We had just gotten here. Nobody knew we were out there. Nobody could find us. We were just, people thought it was ballroom dancing in that studio still. And we got together one night in a prayer meeting on a Sunday night, and we prayed for God to reveal us to the city, use us somehow in the city. I got a call the next day. Long story. I'll explain it more Tuesday if you guys want to know. Just remind me about it. But through some uncircumstances that I could have never put together, they called and asked me to pray over a council meeting at the city for the mayor, previous leadership, and it was turmoil, it was chaos. Of all the times to get asked to go pray, somebody in the audience had slapped a councilwoman the week before. And they said, can you come pray? And I said, I'll pray, but I need to read some scripture too. Is that all right? And they said, sure. And I read this passage of scripture right here, and I just opened my mouth and I said, God the Father is on the throne today. Jesus is king, and he'll raise up who he wants to raise up. He'll tear down who he wants to tear down. And all of a sudden, I started hearing some amens and some hips and hip, and we had church right there. It's amazing what happens when you just say yes. Lord, just use me. Here I am, use me. And what I want you to see today through prayer is that God gave me a desire and us a desire in that small little group in that other building to pray for our city. And that's what we're going to go back to. God gave us a mission 2 years ago. Many of you are new. You don't even know what that is. But it was to pray for every street, every home, every school. Some of you are nodding your heads. You remember that? In a 16-mile radius. It's basically a square around with Destiny Center in the church. We're about halfway at best through that. It fell by the wayside. There were computer problems with the program. I've got to resurrect it because God has been telling me over and over for the last 6 weeks, you've got to do what I said you needed to do. I'm a God of sequence. I'm a God of order. I'm a God of steps. Do we want to know why we're not moving forward? It's because we've got to resurrect that thing, and we've got to pray over every street and every home and every house and every school and every business, whether they're good, bad, or indifferent, in this area so that their hearts would be saturated and ready for the word. God has called us to do that. We all can pray, right? We can do something. None of us can do everything, but all of us can do something. And so God's calling us, first of all, to prayer, to pray. Peter could have never done this miracle if he hadn't went and prayed in that upper room. They stayed there in that upper room until the day of Pentecost, where they were empowered and equipped for the task that God was calling them to do. They prayed three times a day. In the Jewish culture, they still do it now. They no longer offer the evening sacrifice and the morning sacrifice, but it will be reestablished, the Bible says, at some point. But they would go in the evenings. This was a very popular time. Does that sound familiar? Three times a day, just like we're supposed to eat three times a day. Unless you're me, I'm probably a six or maybe a seven. Seven's the number of completion kind of guy. But at least three times a day to get substance, we should pray. Think about that. Just not in the morning, just not at night, just not at Sunday. Really need to pray all throughout the day. I'm learning. God's reinvigorating my mind and my desire to pray. Because when I pray, I have compassion. When I pray, God begins to drop something in my spirit, and all of a sudden I'm concerned about something. I'm concerned about single mothers. I'm concerned about human slavery still happening, or children being abused, or there's not enough money to go around in some homes for Christmas. I'm moved by something, not because someone played with my emotions and they showed me a picture of some dogs that are hurt and broken, or some orphans over in Africa, and I'm moved, and I'm like, I need to give now. If I don't watch Teresa, she'll give it all to those people. She don't like the people to suffer, and I don't either. You don't either. But there's something specific when we pray. There's something that happens inside of us that God begins to burden us for something. And when He begins to burden us, we begin to pray for that person. That's the next step, or that group of people. We begin to pray for those women who have been so abused and been sold into sex slavery. We begin to pray for those children, those orphans, wherever they are. We begin to pray for the people that don't know God out there. We begin to pray for some people that we would be so surprised that we're even praying for. Why? Because God gave us a burden in prayer. And at some point, He would call us to action. At some point, if I pray long enough, God's going to give me an opportunity, a place where I can be used. This place, this day, was at the temple gate. You had the outer court, you had the inner court, and you had the Holy of Holies. Only the priest could go in the Holy of Holies, and he would do the sacrifice in the outer court and then take the offering and the incense into the Lord. There are those that were allowed to go into the outer courts, and they could watch the priest sacrifice. This man, who was lame from birth, could not go into the temple. He couldn't worship. He could only be placed outside the gate, because the Old Testament rule in Leviticus said that anyone who had any kind of imperfection could not enter into a holy God. This is the time and the establishment before Jesus Christ. But now Peter knows that Jesus Christ has come. And so this man is placed in an opportune place. And I read this week, and I've preached on this many times, read it so many more than that. I had just realized that he was carried there right when all this began to happen. So he had some friends. He had some people trying to help him out. He couldn't have got himself there, so he had friends carrying there, and it would put him by the temple gate. This is a perfect place to beg, because right now in the evening sacrifice, this is the last time to come before the Lord that day. The Jewish faith then and now places three things above everything else. That is the Torah, which is God's word. It is also worship. And the third is charity. So think about it. He's sitting there hollering, alms, alms, probably thousands of times a day he hollers alms. This Jewish person's going in. They know they hadn't done that much that day, or they may have done something they shouldn't. They'll say, I'll throw some over here before I go in and talk to God. I'll make it right, right? How many people you hear? When I get myself right, I'm going to come to church. I'm going to go in the temple when I'm all right. I see a lot of heads nodding. You at home, I see your heads too, even though I can't see you. That happens, right? That's how we feel. I got to get myself right before I go in. So this was an opportune place for him to be helped. And Peter and John are in an opportune place to help him from the place of where he is to the place where God wants him to go. And that's what he will do for you. That's what he'll do for me. He'll allow us to be in a season where we can help somebody from the place where they are to the place where God wants them to go. This man could not go into the temple. He could only get to that point. There's so many people out there who are close, who are ripe, who want to come in the house of God, who want to have that relationship with Him. And He's going to put us in the places of the people that need that type of worship. Because Peter said, you're really wanting something for me that I don't have, but what I do have, you may not know it, but I assure you, you need it. In Jesus' name, rise and walk. Now, I want you to think about that, and think about that in terms of benevolence. Think about that in terms of service. God is wanting us not to just give people something. Because it's easy just to give people something. Many of you have been around here. I have people come by here all the time because I'm an easy target. And Margaret, if he's a pastor, surely he's going to give me something. I had somebody hit me up yesterday. And it happens all the time. And it's easier for me just to give them something and let them go. That's the easiest thing to do. The hardest thing to do is teach them differently than the habit and the cycle that they're in. Does that make sense to everybody in the house? That if we're going to have benevolence, and we're going to have benevolence in the house of God, after three times of asking for benevolence, we need to go through some financial training. We need to go through some classes. If it's addiction, we need to help them and provide a path for them to grow and move forward. Why? Because God wants to take them from the place where they are, where they're not having to be needy on someone all the time, where they put all of their needs on Him, and then eventually they're going to have such a surplus in their life that they're going to be giving to someone else. And that's the way that God works. That's the principle of the kingdom of heaven. I once was blind, but now I see. This man once was lame, but now he can walk. He can earn his own living. He didn't have to sit around and beg anymore. And now he doesn't have to hear the worship and hear the singing outside. He can come in. Think about how valuable and how precious meeting in the house of God is to him. Rose to his feet, began to walk and began to leap and began to pray. God's going to give us these divine places, these prime locations for us. And we don't have to worry about that. All you need to do, all I need to do is every day say yes. And when I say yes, then all of a sudden my eyes are opened up to things I could have never even thought about, that I could have never even seen before. Because I had said yes to God to do something, and many other yeses to that point, and me feeling like I was up against a wall because I felt I was going to plant a church when I'd got to that point of yeses, and I knew I was going to plant a church. I felt for sure it would be in my hometown of Starkville. I already had 50 people who were doing outreaches all over the city with me. We already had these tons of people we're discipling, but door after door after door closed. And so finally, I just said yes to wherever and however and whatever you want to do. And when I was getting gas on this highway 11 years ago, God said, this is the place. This is the time. But I never say yes to that without saying yes every day. So today, I don't want you to be nervous about saying yes. Sometimes we think about saying yes to serving God like we do about praying for patience. Don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. But really, it's what you're created to do. I would say to you, really, how happy are you all? Are you right now? The happiest I am is when I'm giving my life away. When I feel the most alive and the most value in my life is when I'm doing something God asked me to do. And you'll be the same way because you're created for that moment. You're created for that time. You're created for that place. Think about all the times that this man had begged for money over and over, and Peter said, hey, look at me. Look into my eyes. And not just Peter. John's right beside me. Look at us. We don't have silver and we don't have gold. But what we have is a man that redeemed me, a man that called me, and I failed him so many times, but yet he's redeemed me again. And he told me I could do things like he did. I'm going to put my hand right here by your hand, and I'm going to pick you up, and I believe with all of my heart by the name. When you say name, he invoked the person. He invoked the character. He invoked everything of who Jesus Christ was. And he said, I'm going to reach down, and I'm going to say in the name of Jesus, and all of a sudden he's going to heal you, and you're going to rise and walk. Can you imagine church? Can you imagine? I've seen it before. I've seen him take ears that couldn't hear and allow them to hear. I've seen him take mute people and allow them to speak who were that way from birth. I've seen it with all of my heart, and you would think I would be stirred up all the time. But life takes its toll on us. We forget the power. We forget the love. We forget the place that we're in. We forget everything because the enemy's got us so distracted. And all of a sudden, we think we're in a place that we can't be used. But I assure you today, all we have to do is say yes. God's plan is always about us serving others out of the surplus that we already have. How much greater do we have than Jesus Christ? How much more than we have than faith, hope, and love? Silver and gold are going to go away. And the Bible says in the book of James now, if we just say we're going to pray for you when somebody asks for money and just pat them on the head, that's faith without action. That's not what I'm saying today. I'm not saying belittle people, but I'm saying that say yes. And we don't value our possessions. Let's go there. We think sometimes that we have to do that mighty miracle that I just mentioned. We think sometimes that we got to give somebody 10 grand to help something because my few dollars won't make a difference. I assure you, little is much when God is in it. And our possessions are always undervalued by us, and we always overvalue somebody else's possessions. Does anybody agree with that? You don't have to raise your hand. I'm just doing this as a signification to just say that that's me. A lot of times I undervalue what I have, but I overvalue what somebody else has. Why? Because I'm pining away. If I'm not careful, I'm coveting, which is a sin, and it's going to make my heart discontent. It's going to make me hollow. It's going to make me not realize what I really have. It's amazing what a smile will do. It's amazing when you see somebody finishing up their groceries and they've got a buggy and you're already taking, I cannot stand having to take my buggy and put it over there. I really want to leave it, but I know God's not happy when I do that. And so I have to take my buggy and put it in the car down in the parking lot. If you do the other, don't feel convicted unless he convicts you tomorrow. He might now that I've said that to you. But I always go and I thought, well, if I'm doing it, why not do it for somebody else? They probably hate it as bad as I do. It's amazing how many smiles you get and how many, oh my goodness, when they're finishing up and you just happen to do that. It's not that I pray every day, Lord, give me a buggy to get today. It's not that I even look at it, but sometimes I see it and I'm like, oh, Lord, I done prayed about that. Do I need to get that buggy or not? Because sometimes it comes at an inconvenient time. But can't I do that? Surely I take time out to do that. What about a text to somebody? What about a phone call? What about opening the door for somebody? It's amazing. I will tell you today that multiple times for people that are not part of this body, but they happen through here. Some were traveling. Some just happened to be in here and they've gone back out. Hopefully they're planted somewhere. But I can tell you I've received handwritten notes. I've received emails anonymously. I've received texts from people I didn't know and they said, I was planning on taking my life today. But I came to your faith family and with you in worship, and I know that I have value. I felt the love of the people. I felt worth. We never know. We don't know what's happening. We don't know what somebody's going through. All we need to do is say yes. You don't have to go around looking for that every day. You just say yes and allow God to use what you have. All of us have something that's unique. All of us have relationships that are unique. God may use you in ways, and I'm almost positive that every day that I say use me, even though I go to bed and I'm like, I didn't do anything for God today, I assure you he used you. He's just looking for you to say yes. All of us have something in our possession that we can give. Why? If we know Jesus Christ, that's the greatest value of anything. Faith, hope, and love. Peter gave him something that would last forever. He didn't give him a few little alms where he could just get by to the next day. He gave him something that would change his life. That's the important thing that you and I need to see today. That God can use anything. Little is much when God's in it. None of us can do everything, but all of us can do something. I think about all the things of Peter and how he must have lowered the value of himself after he denied Jesus those three times and how Jesus restored him and how the first thing that Jesus told him when he was cleaning his nets was, follow me. And if you go back and you look at where he was restored in the book of John on the shore and he said, do you love me, Peter? He said, Lord, I love you. You know I love you. And three times he said, feed my sheep. Peter, you're the rock. I'm going to build my church on people just like you. Woo, mercy. I'm going to build my church on people that have failed me. I'm going to build my church on people that thought more of themselves than they should. I'm going to build my church on mistakes. I'm going to build my church on imperfect things so they can see how good and perfect I am. With me, all things are possible, Peter. And the last thing he says to Peter in the book of John is, follow me. That's all he's saying to us today. Say yes to my will. Say yes to my way. And the rest is going to be fine. Don't worry about the cost. Don't worry about what you're going to give and what you're not going to give. Just let me use you. I promise all of us have something that we can be used by the Lord by. If I do something and I give an invitation to somebody to pray, or I give an invitation to come to church, sometimes they may or may not accept, but don't give up. Just keep asking, just making sure that they know the door is open. God's going to put us in these places. He's going to put us in these opportunities. I believe with all my heart that Peter and John were looking for something that day to be used by God. I believe they were having a conversation about, man, Jesus said we could do miracles like he could. Because this is the first one of a disciple. And after the day of Pentecost, do you think that could happen, John? I don't know. What do you think? I don't know. Let's pray about that when we go to the prayer meeting today. Okay, sounds good. Here's the beggar. John looks at Peter. Peter looks at John. What you think? I think the Lord's stirring my heart. I think I feel him just like I felt him on that day that he filled me full. Let's go talk to him. Let's go see. Let's go do. And that's all God's asking you to do. Just talk about him. Learn about him. Pray. Find that deep relationship in him. And then when the opportunity comes, he's not having to get through all this other stuff because you've already cleaned your heart out. You've already given him the matters of your heart. Your heart's overflowing. You're looking for opportunities. There's so many times when we go just to receive. And I'm not saying that you shouldn't. I ask the Lord that I could receive from him today in his house with worshiping with you, because there's nothing like corporate worship. People are forgetting that, but they won't forget it for long. They need it. We need corporate worship. And I needed something today. But there's that time in our lives where we should mature enough where we're not only looking to receive when we come together, we're not only looking to receive when we go out, but we're also looking to give. Amen? So, in closing today, I just want to talk to you about revival. There's a lot of talk about revival. And revival is the stirring and the increase and the movement of God where hearts are stirred to accept him as Lord and Savior. There's a lot of us out there that believe another Acts chapter 2 experience would usher in revival. That really that power and that manifestation of miracles would really help. And I am here to tell you I believe that as well. Because Jesus performed miracles and they were a dinner bell to hear the gospel. But I'm also telling you today that I think revival in these last days will be different than any of us have ever seen. God's always doing something new. He's always challenging our religious and our rituals and all the other things. And I believe with all my heart that this last revival will become through us serving the world. We'll talk more about this next week. The last thing that Jesus did with his disciples before he went to the garden was wash their feet. He was trying to explain to him, this is how you reach the world. We're going to reach the world, and we're going to see revival, I believe, by the way we serve one another. By the way we serve those people that don't look like us, that don't act like us, that even maybe cause us to get angry and rub us the wrong way. That's why I believe revival comes, because the church really becomes the church. That it's not just about consumerism. It's not just about what we can come and believe me, I challenge myself, and I am challenged today preaching and teaching to you about you doing something rather than you receiving something. All of us want to come and hear how we can get something. I mean, that's just human nature. But I promise you, the more God pours himself out in you and the more he makes you whole, the more something's going to stir inside of you, and you're going to say, I need something to do. And you're going to be chomping at the bit, and when it comes, you're going to be ready. God's going to use you, and you're going to know that you were created for a purpose. Every person out there in that world right now wants to know that they were created for a purpose. Many of you are nodding your heads. You want to know that you have value, that you have purpose, that you have meaning. I assure you, you do. But it will come through serving someone else. It will come being the hands and feet of the Lord. They're about to sing us a new song by a group that we do a lot of their songs. Elevation is called Available. And it's simply just singing, I am available. And I remember the first time that I heard a song like that, a little over a decade ago, about Here I Am, Use Me, the words of that song. And I remember my heart stirring so much. And I remember just coming and saying, you know what? I'll do whatever. I'm so full of you. I'm so full of my life. I don't want my life without you. I don't want to do anything without you. I desire for that passion to stir in me again. I desire to be rekindled. I desire to be renewed. I desire for you to do the same. I desire to see people saved in this house every week. I desire to see them saved in the streets because we're serving them. God's going to give us something to do. What he's looking today is, will you say yes? I'm going to say yes. I'm going to tell him that I don't know where I am, and I don't know what I'm doing, and I'm lost, and I'm going through parts of my life that I've never been through before, and I feel like everything's upside down in my heart and my spirit. But I know that I'm ready for him, and I want to do whatever he wants me to do, and I want to be whatever he wants to do, and I know I'm not there, but I desire nothing more than to find him when I seek him with all my heart. Would you sing that with me today? Would you just tell him, I am available. Let's sing it together. Let's stand together and let's worship. this church is blessed. Young adults who have a heart to serve. And I want to be good stewards with them. I want to put them to work. And I want them to inspire those of us that have grown weary. God wants to put the families back together. From the youngest to the oldest, serving. Serving God with joy. Serving God because we matter. How many people are not in the house of the Lord today because they feel like they don't need anything or they're not needed? I am here to tell you today that His presence is in this house. He is in this place. And I'm about to pray for you. And I'll have a moment where I can pray for you and lay hands on you. But right now, at home and in this house, let's just get in a posture of prayer. If you need healing in your body, if you're like that lame beggar this morning, I'm about to pray that you be healed. And I pray in the name of Jesus the Nazarene that you be healed in your body today. Heavenly Father, touch everybody in this house and everyone that's online, anyone that needs healing, God, I pray for healing in their bodies today. May they be restored and may they be renewed. Lord, I need healing in my body. My body is not recovered. I pray, God, that you would strengthen and sustain. I'll give you all the glory and I'll give you all the honor. By the stripes of Jesus, we are healed today. And I declare healing in the name of Jesus today. Amen. And there may be someone in this house or online and you feel Jesus calling you today. You feel Him calling you to a relationship. Not just the salvation, not just something you said when you were smaller or something that somebody told you to say, but you feel Jesus calling you and you feel unworthy. You feel the sin in your life causing you to have grief and conviction. It's okay. Give it to Him right now in Jesus' name. Cast your sin upon Him. He gave His life for you. His blood is enough. You are forgiven. If you ask for forgiveness, you are forgiven. In Jesus' name, receive the freedom of the Lord. Receive the salvation of the Lord. I pray today that you develop a relationship with Him. And I pray for all of our prayers to be renewed, church. I pray that it be stirred. Let's make a commitment this week that we're going to pray three times a day. It doesn't have to be these long things, but let's just pray three times a day. Let's just make ourselves available. Let's ask God to use us in places that we're already going and things that we already have, possessions that are already in our lives and our hearts. Today is the day that we can begin again. Today is the day that we can be renewed, that we can be restored. Today is the day for many of us that we're going to say yes. Will you say yes to Him this morning? As they sing it again, let that be your yes. I'm here to pray with you if you need prayer today.
I hear you call, I am available, I say, yes, Lord, I am available, here I am, here I am, you can have it all.
about what's going to happen Tuesday, fear about getting corona, fear about getting corona again, whatever. Their world is just full of fear. Can we ask the Lord today to give us a sense of peace and that our faith would overcome our fear together? Father, I pray right now against the spirit of fear in the name of Jesus. Lord, that you would drive fear from every person that knows you, that our hearts would be rekindled, that we would be renewed in our faith today, that we would not be concerned or worried because you are on the throne. We will do our part, God. You gave us wisdom. You gave us free will. You gave us the ability in this country to vote. We shall do it with conviction. But Lord, we believe with all of our hearts that you are on the throne, that you raise kings up and you tear them down, that your will is ultimately going to happen in this earth. And we say yes to your will and yes to your way today. Lord, we may become ill, as I have. But Lord, our destiny, if we are to recover, we will recover. We will be renewed, God. We will not let this hinder our work for you. In Jesus' name. Amen, church. Amen. Our Monday mission is pretty easy. I will present myself before the Lord daily to serve him and others. I will say yes and make myself available. Will you do that this week? Let's make a commitment to pray three times a day. Let's make ourselves available. And I look forward to the testimonies that's going to come in about how God used us. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his countenance rest upon you. May you go from this place today blessed of the Lord, full of his spirit, full of his love, full of his grace. And may you say yes to his will and his way this week. In Jesus' name, amen.